Good morning and welcome to South Point Church Online. We want to welcome those of you watching in our local communities here in Southern Maryland. We also want to welcome those of you watching in different parts of the country and maybe even different parts of the world. My name is Matt. I'm part of the team here at South Point. And on behalf of our amazing staff and volunteers, we want to say thanks for joining us today. Hey, we're on week two of a series called God of the Underdogs. Now, last week, I was really excited about this series. And this week, I want you to be excited about this series, and here's why. Listen, at some point, all of us, regardless of whether we have some faith, maybe even different faith or no faith, right? At some point, all of us in life will face overwhelming odds where losing seems certain. Matter of fact, last week together, we admitted this truth that we're going to put up on the screen. It's this: when overwhelmed, we often settle for the mediocre or medicating our pain. And listen, when you and I settle for the mediocre or we seek to medicate our pain, we never end up with the life that we want or the life that we're meant for. Because at the end of the day, here's the truth about life. At some point in life, all of us will face a label we can't seem to overcome, a weakness we can't seem to beat, or a circumstance we can't control. But last week, we discovered this amazing great news, and I'm gonna put it up on the screen. It's this: it's not our status, it's not our strength, and it's not our situation that determines our destiny. It's Jesus. And when I say Jesus, I wanna make sure that if you're here and you're kind of watching today and you don't know about Jesus, I'm not talking about a church building, I'm not talking about a church organization, I'm talking about a personal relationship with Jesus. He determines our destiny. Now, if you're joining us today and you missed last week, that's really okay. You can catch up on our website, or you can go to our YouTube channel and catch up. I really want to encourage anyone who's watching to like our Facebook page, to subscribe to our YouTube channel, or to follow us on Instagram. I don't know if you know this, but every day we deliver content through those mediums to help connect you to other people and to connect you to God. So you might want to do that. Hey, in this week two of this message, we're going to dive right into a truth that I believe applies to all of us. And this isn't a non-Christian issue or a Christian issue. This is a human issue. And here's the truth that we want to dive right into this morning. And it's this right here: a rescue without restoration is just a delayed loss. Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. Imagine yourself on the way to an important meeting, right? You're driving into an important meeting, your car breaks down on the side of the road, right? A rescue is where someone sees you on the side of the road and they get you to the meeting. Restoration is your car gets fixed so that you can continue to use it on a daily basis. No one wants to just get a ride to that important meeting. They want the problem solved. And the reality is, a rescue without restoration is a delayed loss. And here's what I know to be true about me. I know this to be true about you and to be true about all of us. No one wants to experience a delayed loss. We all want to experience not just a rescue, but restoration. Matter of fact, I discovered this principle the hard way. I discovered it in both a personal and painful way. It was about a decade ago. I got really sick. Matter of fact, I didn't expect it, but I got so sick. At the time, I was the pastor at South Point Church. I couldn't speak in the sermon or give the message for six straight weeks. And I was a healthy guy. I'm about 5'11", right? And I weighed about 170 pounds at that time and in shape. And I dropped to under 130 pounds. Matter of fact, I was so sick, there'd be days where I just wished and I felt like I was dying. Finally, I got in front of a doctor who was able to help me, and he prescribed some medicine. And I'll never forget what the doctor said to me as he was prescribing this medicine. He looked me straight in the eye and he goes, "Listen, I have this medicine that will help take care of the symptoms so you don't feel like you're dying. But I do want to let you know the truth about this medicine. We call this the divorce drug." I mean, think about that. That was my two options, is to continue to feel like I'm dying or take a medicine that he called the divorce drug. And here's what happened. He gave me the medicine and it did help. It got rid of the symptoms. But man, it took a person like me who's already a little bit crazy and made me a whole lot crazy. Now, this medicine that was supposed to help me feel better actually went through like a 4 or 5 week cycle where I'd start at like a high dose and then go down and kind of wean off. Unfortunately, at the end of every 4 or 5 week cycle where I kind of start to go off the medicine, I would get really sick again. And this went on for almost 2 years. You see, The medicine was a rescue, but as soon as I stopped taking the medicine, I got sick. I didn't have restoration. So it was really just a delayed loss. What I discovered through changing my diet and my sleep patterns, my work patterns, and some health patterns in my life is I needed more than a rescue. I needed restoration. And it leads to a truth that's true for you, and it's true for me, and it's true for all of us, is that without a restoration, our rescue really is just a delayed loss, which leads to another truth that is really, really hard. Matter of fact, when I wrote the next truth down, I went ouch. Matter of fact, it's one of those moments that we would call here at South Point a buckle up moment, because when I wrote this following truth down, I kind of squinched a little bit and said, ow, that hurts. So I want you to buckle up. Maybe you want to type that in the chat, but I think this truth is really important for us to hear, and I'm going to put it up on the screen, and it's this. Asking God for a rescue without seeking restoration is a dysfunctional request. When you and I want a rescue, but don't really want restoration, that's really just a dysfunctional request. You already know this. I'm about to tell you something that you know and you've experienced. Listen, when we try to rescue someone from a problem that we know they're going to end up right back in that same problem, you understand this. I understand that. That isn't helpful, right? That rescue isn't helpful. We have a word in our society that we call enabling. When we rescue someone that we know is going to get right back in that situation, that isn't helpful. That's enabling. And it got me thinking, listen, if unreligious people know that if you rescue somebody only to have them get back right into the same situation, that that's not helpful, it's just enabling, I'm pretty sure God knows that too. And it leaves all of us. So if you showed up today and you're viewing this and you go, I don't know if I have faith. If you showed up and you're watching this and you go, I kind of grew up in a different faith. And maybe you're watching this and you said, listen, I've been following Jesus for a while. It leaves all of us, because it's a human issue, addressing this hard truth that leads us to a relevant question. And here's the relevant question. When we are facing overwhelming odds, how do we seek more than just a rescue? How do we seek restoration? And this is where I get fired up to be together today, is listen, God knew that every person in every generation would struggle with this issue. Matter of fact, this is the very reason that Jesus came, that Jesus died on the cross, and that Jesus conquered hell and death, and that the tomb is empty. Because Jesus knew that our rescue had to include restoration. Today, we're going to look at an encounter Jesus had with someone that's somewhat unique, but kind of hits home to this point of that we need more than a rescue, we need a restoration. Because when you and I ask for a rescue without seeking restoration, it really is a dysfunctional request. And no one wants a delayed loss. Now, I want to kind of set up this encounter with Jesus. We find it in the eyewitness account of the Gospel of Luke, Luke 7. Now, Jesus has been invited over to dinner by a Pharisee. Now, a Pharisee is a religious leader of the day. Now, the Pharisee's job is to know a lot about God and to be able to tell people like what God likes, what God is wants from people, and what he's like and what's important to him. And so the Pharisee's job primarily is to know as much about God and then that communicate that with people. And this is why Jesus was always kind of in disagreement with the Pharisees. Jesus, being God's son, knew God better than the Pharisees. And so one of the Pharisees invited Jesus over for dinner, but he didn't give Jesus any of the customary pleasantries and hospitality that he would normally give a guest. And so they're sitting there, they're at the meal, and we're gonna pick it up in Luke 7. We're gonna put it up on the screen, and it's here. It says, a woman in a town who lived a sinful life learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house. So I'm gonna stop here and kind of share what's happening. So Jesus gets invited by this Pharisee to his house for dinner. And they're in this middle of the meal. And it says, a woman who lived a sinful life. And here's what's odd about that word sinful life. It doesn't mean that she made a mistake. It doesn't mean that like she got something wrong once. She had a reputation. It said a sinful life. Now, it doesn't tell us what that sinful life actually was. But most historians, most theologians mean the implication is that for some reason, she had either been married or divorced multiple times. Maybe there was some immorality in her life. She might have even been a prostitute. And the reality is she was facing a situation that all of us face. Now, it may look different, but she ended up with the label that she couldn't overcome. She apparently had a weakness that she couldn't beat, and she had a circumstance that she couldn't control. She was a woman born in an era where women weren't given rights. They were considered second-class citizens, and the only value they usually brought was based on their attractiveness and their ability to bear children. She ended up in a place that she didn't want to be, and she needed something different. And so she came there with an alabaster jar of perfume. Now I'm gonna come back to that alabaster jar of perfume later in the message, so just don't forget she came with that. And as she stood behind him, being Jesus, at his feet, weeping. And so in this encounter, Jesus shows up and he's having dinner with this Pharisee, right? And they're probably talking about God. And this woman who has a label she can't overcome, she has some weakness she can't beat, and she's got the circumstance she can't control, right? And she's weeping at the feet of Jesus. She's brought some perfume and she's anointing his feet and cleaning his feet and she's doing all that. Meanwhile, the other guests and this Pharisee who invited Jesus over, you're probably going, well, I wonder what their reaction was. Well, you and I aren't left guessing what their reaction is. Matter of fact, the author Luke tells us what the reaction is. We're going to put up here. It says the Pharisee, again, the guy who's supposed to know God and then tell people what God is like and how to react to him, who invited him, Jesus, saw this and he said to himself, and he was like thinking, man, if Jesus was really the Son of God, if Jesus was really a prophet, if this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him. And basically the idea is listen, anybody with a label, anybody with a weakness, anybody with a circumstance that they can't overcome, I mean, if they're that kind of person, God or someone who's godly probably wouldn't want to be associated with that person. He would know who it is that's touching him and what kind of woman she is and that she is a sinner. She had a label, she had a weakness, and she had a circumstance. And his basic premise in these couple of verses is this, is that God doesn't want to be touched. God doesn't want to partner with, and God doesn't want to care about people like her. And the reality is, and this is what the Pharisee misunderstood, is that her story is all of our story. Because at some point in life, all of us will face one of those things in a way where we need something outside of ourselves. We'll need God to step in to fix what only he can fix. Jesus, knowing what he thinks, begins to tell the Pharisee a story. And he says, hey, listen, there were two people who were indebted. One owed a little bit of money and one owed a lot of money. Neither one of them could pay. And he says, the person that they owed the debt to forgave both of their debts. And then he asked this question to the Pharisee. He said, who do you think loved the person who forgave the debt the most? And the Pharisee, being a sharp guy, an educated guy, said, well, probably the one who was forgiven the most. And then we see Jesus' response to the woman who had showed up and poured the perfume on his feet and had washed his feet and had been shedding tears in that moment. And here's the words of Jesus that give us hope that there's a God who loves us and a God who is for us. Here's what Jesus says. And then Jesus said to her, your sins are forgiven. Your faith have saved you. Go in peace. Now I want to stop on this last word, peace, because the New Testament comes to us from Luke. And because Luke wants to share it to multiple people, that Luke is not written in Jewish, in Hebrew. It's actually written in the language of the day, Greek. But Jesus, being Jewish, would have used the word for peace, which would have been shalom. And there's no word in the English language for this word peace that a Jewish person would use, because the word peace that Jesus would have used in this situation would be all-encompassing. It would talk about wellness and wholeness and unity, this broad spectrum that speaks across every area of life. Basically, he was looking here and saying, I understand that you need more than a rescue. You need restoration. You know, I don't know what you think about this encounter with this woman with Jesus, but to me, she is a hero. There's three things that she displays in this encounter that I think are true of all of us who are underdogs that we need to have. The first thing that she displayed that all underdogs should have is humility. She realized that she had a situation that by herself she couldn't fix, and she was willing to go to Jesus to get it fixed. The second thing is her courage. Can you imagine the courage? She knew the reputation she had. She knew she was stepping into the house of a Pharisee. Yet she courageously went to a place where she didn't care what people thought about her. She didn't care that they would sneer and make faces. She had the courage to go, "I don't care what they think. I only care about what Jesus thinks." And then lastly, Not only did she have humility, not only did she have courage, she stepped into a situation and she was willing to surrender. And we're going to talk about that in a little bit. But this passage, this encounter, leads to a couple of observations that are so true that when you and I are underdogs and we're facing overwhelming odds, instead of crying out just for a rescue, how do we seek restoration? And so the first observation is this, so we're going to put it up on the screen, it's this. Restoration happens when we make space for God to show up. You know, what's amazing about this story is she doesn't wait for Jesus to find her. She creates space for Jesus to speak in to her life. It reminds me of dealing with the cable company. I don't know how many of you probably have an internet provider. If you're watching this, you're either using your cell phone or you have some kind of landline or satellite system to deliver internet. And here's what I know, because I've had to deal with a cable company before, and you've probably had to deal with this. Have you ever had to have someone come fix your internet? Can you just type in internet in your chat? Because that's always a pain, right? But have you ever heard what they say, right? Whenever you call them and ask them to come do service, like on your internet, they always go, "Well, here's the times we have." And they usually give it to you in like 4 or 6 hour blocks. We have like, you know, 10 to 2, 12 to 4, or 2 to like 6. And you're like, "So I've got to sit around and give up 4 hours for someone to show up for a few minutes?" And their answer is yes. If you want that service, you have to make space. And what I love about this encounter is that restoration happens when we make space for God to show up. You see, an underdog is humble enough to realize they can't overcome the overwhelming odds without somebody outside of themselves showing up, and that is God. And for God to show up, we need to make space, which leads me directly into observation number two, which is this: making space means letting go. Now, I don't know about you, but my vacation this past summer looked very different than I imagined, but I'm really grateful. We as a family got a chance to get away and take a little bit of vacation. And whenever we go on vacation, we take our family van. And whenever we go on vacation and get away for our family van always needs a cleaning out and a removing of all the stuff. Now, I don't know if this is true of your family, but I know it's true of our family. For some reason, our family van becomes a portable storage system. Can I just get storage, right? You can just type that in the chat. For some reason, like old library books, stuff that needs to go to the recycling centers, stuff that we are going to give back to friends, things that we don't know how, somehow end up in the back of their van. And every time we get ready to go on the vacation, we need to move all this stuff out so we can have a good vacation and put the things that we want and need to experience what we want in the van. And so here's a reality. And this is true whether you're not a follower of Jesus or if you're a follower of Jesus. Making space means letting go. And today, at the crux of this, this is so important. There are three specific things that all of us will need to let go of to make space for God to show up in our life, for Him to do what only He can do. And here's the first thing we'll need to let go, and I'm going to put them all up here. The first thing is hurt. Here's the truth about life. All of us will experience hurt in life. We may experience it from family, we may experience it from friends or coworkers, or people that we trust or whatever, but at some point, all of us will experience hurt in life. And like in the Frozen song, "Let It Go," at some point, we need to let hurt go. And here's why. If you and I don't let hurt go, then we allow a single hurt to continually, repeatedly harm us. And when you and I let a past hurt continually harm us, that is unhealthy and it's horrific. And so at some point, to make space for God, we're going to have to let go of a hurt. For some of us, we might say something like, God, why did you let that hurt happen? And I'm very sure that God didn't want that hurt to happen, but that we live in a busted and broken world with busted and broken people. At some point, to make space for God to step into our story, we're going to have to let go of a hurt. We're going to have to let go of a half-truth. The reality is, at some point, all of us, I've done this, I know you've done this, we've all done this, right? We've all bought into a lie about ourselves, maybe a lie about other people, and maybe even a lie about God. And the reality is to make space for God to show up. At some point, we're gonna have to let go of the lies about ourselves, the lies about others, and the lies about God. And then the last thing we have to let go of is hindrances. Now listen, here's what I've discovered. If you're human, you have a hindrance. And here's how I know this. It's because human beings, whether you're not a follower of Jesus or you're a follower of Jesus, all of us fall into this trap, right? Humans inherently like things that feel good, but aren't always good for them. Can I just get an amen, right? Like, you can just type amen in the chat if you want. True story, just this past week, my wife had gone to the grocery store, and she'd asked me before she left, she found this popcorn. It's like kettle popcorn, but it's like sweet and salty at the same time. And she's like, hey, do you want me to get some of that? I was like, yes, please. I love this popcorn. So she got a bag of it. And I said, you know what? I'm just gonna have a little bit. So I grabbed the bag, I opened it, and I was sitting on the couch, and I was watching a show. And about an hour later, I realized that I was that guy, right? Like, I had crumbs in my beard from the popcorn. It was all over my shirt, and most of the bag was gone. And I looked at myself and said, what is going on? How did I eat almost a whole bag of popcorn? It felt good, but it wasn't good for me. For you and I to create space for God to show up, we'll need to make space by letting go of the hurt, the half-truths, and the hindrance. And then here's the third observation from the encounter Jesus had with this woman, and it's this. Everyone, you, me, we, everyone faces a daily choice. This is a daily choice. This isn't a once-in-a-lifetime choice. This is a daily choice that we'll make between self-preservation or surrender. You know, what's so amazing about this encounter that Jesus had with this woman who lived a sinful life? You know, we don't know if she had been divorced or married. We don't know if she was a prostitute. What we do know is that what she brought to Jesus was this alabaster jar that was full of perfume. Matter of fact, Judas got so mad when she used it on Jesus because he said, that is so valuable, we could use that to give to the poor. Now, Judas really wasn't concerned about the poor. He was taking money out of the offering, right? But this perfume, this jar represented financial security. And if she was a female and it was perfume, it probably made her maybe look good or smell good. And so it was security. It was financial security. It was security for kind of her culture and for her. And what's amazing is instead of keeping something that would cause her to preserve or focus on self-preservation, she surrendered it to Jesus. And every day when we're underdogs and we're facing the overwhelming odds and we need to move not just from rescue but to restoration, you, me, we will face the daily choice. Will we choose to act in self-preservation or will we choose to surrender to what God has told us? And if I was gonna sum this all up in one kind of sentence, here's how I'd sum it up, and it would go something like this. Letting go to make space for God to show up is how underdogs find more than rescue. You see, when we're facing the overwhelming odds that make losing certain, we need something other than ourselves, and we need more than just a rescue. We need a restoration. And so how do we experience that? We need to let go of things that make space for God to show up into our story so that we don't have just a rescue in the moment that leads right back to the same place that we were in. But that when we allow God to show up in our space, we don't just get a rescue, we get a restoration and wholeness and goodness. And so I want to close with an analogy, and I'm going to put it up on the screen. I don't know if you've ever heard of a monkey trap. And so I don't know if you've heard of this analogy, but like in India, in certain parts of India, monkeys are like pests that we have. Consider like rats or raccoons, right? They go into their trash and their homes and into their gardens, and so they don't want them. And so like, well, how do we trap them so that we can let them go back into the forest? And if anyone's going, that's an ugly drawing, don't worry, I didn't draw that right. But anyway, the way that they would catch monkeys in certain parts of India is what they do is they take a chain and they put it in the ground and they tie it, and then they have a coconut and they cut a really small hole in it and they empty the coconut out, and in the coconut they put a small banana, or sometimes they'll put a lot of rice. And what will happen is the monkey will come to eat and grab something, and they'll slide their hand into the hole, right? But as soon as they grab the banana, or as soon as they grab the rice, and they go to pull it out, their hand can't fit through the hole and they are stuck. And then when they see the person coming to get them, to capture them, they're scared, they want to run away, but they are unwilling to, just type in the chat, folks, you already know what's coming. They're unwilling to what? Let it go. And so freedom was within their grasp, but they never experienced the freedom that they could because they're unwilling to let it go. And so last week, my challenge to you of going, what is it that you can do? I said, come back this week. And so this week I have a specific challenge, and I want to give the specific challenge to two groups of people. The first one is you're here and you kind of caught on to this thing, and you may have never actually said yes to Jesus. You may know about Jesus. You may even believe in Jesus. You may even like Jesus, but you've never actually said yes to Jesus. Maybe there's a hurt that you can't seem to let go of. And maybe there's a hindrance that you know in your life that you want to hold on to, that you need to let go. Maybe there's a truth about yourself or others or God that you just need to let go. That anyone that would die for you is for you. Today is the day to let go and let Jesus step into your heart and life and to fill you with his presence so that you can live the life that you were meant for. And if that's you today, here's what I'd like you to do. There'll be a little spot where you can click like a little hand to say, today I am saying yes to Jesus. I am letting go of being self-sufficient, and I will surrender and let Jesus be my sufficiency. Now, the second group of people are people that are here and watching, and you've already said yes to Jesus, but there's a hurt. Maybe there's a hindrance, and maybe there's a half-truth that keeps you stuck in life. And if you're here today, and there's a hurt that you haven't addressed, and you're like the monkey, and you're unwilling to let it go, and you're stuck, and you're facing overwhelming odds, and you need a rescue, and you need more than a rescue, you need restoration. I want to ask, would you let that hurt go? If you need a Stevens minister, you know, you can request that through our website or through our phone. Maybe if you need professional counseling, we have access to those things. Would you let that hurt go so that God can step into your situation? If you're here and there's a half-truth that you go, God couldn't love someone like me, I need you to let that go. Maybe you have this idea that I don't really need God, or that I'm right just the way I am, and that my story excuses my behavior, that you would let that go, that you would let go of that half-truth, that you would allow Jesus to step in. Maybe it's a hindrance. The reality is all of us have behaviors and actions and choices that we make that don't honor God, that feel good in the moment, but aren't good for us. They're not good for others, and they don't honor God. And at the end of the day, we can hold on to self-preservation, and that little thing can be chained to the consequences when we do things that harm ourselves and others. Or, like the woman who encountered Jesus, we can let it go. And we can lay it at the feet of Jesus, because we need more than a rescue. We need a restoration, because Jesus died and conquered hell and death. Here's his own words in John 10. He says, I've come that you might have life, and life to the full. God wants more than a rescue for you. He wants restoration, because he wants none of us to experience a delayed loss. So my hope and my prayer for all of us today is that we would let it go and surrender it to God so that we wouldn't experience just a rescue, but restoration. Let me pray for us. Hey, God, thank you that you loved us so much, that Jesus showed what God is really like, and that He's willing to touch and to be a part and to be engaged in people's lives who have a label, who have weaknesses, and who have circumstances that they control. And you are more than willing to step into that and to create restoration. For God so loved the world that He gave. But God, at some point, you're a gentleman, and at some point we need to surrender and we need to let go. We need to create space for you to work. And I pray today that whether there's a hurt or half-truth or hindrance, that today would be the day that we let that go and we make space for you to show up in our story so that we can experience the life that we want and the life that we are meant for because we said yes to Jesus. This is our hope and our prayer. In Christ's name, amen. We hope that you never forget that you matter deeply to God.